Hi there. I'm back for the second part of this two-part series on file formats. In the first part, we covered a lot of information about raw files, and if you've not seen it, I'd recommend that you go back and check it out. But in this video, we're going to cover lots of other file formats. Now, one of the most important concepts for you to understand here is about compression and lossless files versus lossy files. So we're going to start with that and then move into the individual formats themselves. So firstly, what is compression? Well, compression is all about getting rid of unused image data to make your file size smaller. And there are a number of ways that you can compress files. One of the easiest ways to think about it is comparing it to a book. So if I was to digitize a book, you see at the end of each chapter, there's a lot of space before the next chapter comes in. And if I delete all of those spaces, I can compress the size of that book because it's not going to take up as many pages anymore. But I can recover that because if I know that each chapter starts with the word chapter, every time I see the word chapter, I can say, let's end the page there, create a space and start a new page. So I can recover what the book looked like. So that's an analogy for a lossless compression. It has been compressed, but it can be recovered. However, if I compressed it in a slightly different way and said, let's remove any spaces between words whatsoever, then that final file would be a heck of a lot smaller than just removing the spaces at the end of the chapter. But it would also not be recoverable because it would be very difficult to work out what each individual word was. Therefore, the second type of compression is what's called lossy. So we lose information and we can't get the information back. So now let's move on to JPEGs. And JPEGs are both useful, really great files and absolutely awful. So let's cover what that means. Well, one of the reasons that JPEGs are great is because the internet works on JPEGs. All of our browsers and websites are programmed to deal in JPEGs. The whole internet is covered in JPEGs. They're really easy to transfer, they're quick to download, and so the internet runs on JPEGs, and that's why they're so useful. But they're also awful because, as I mentioned in part one, they are only 8-bit files. A bit is a computing term for a binary digit, and each bit can hold either a value of 1 or 0. So 8 bits means 8 ones or zeros. So every combination of 8 ones or zeros works like this. 8 zeros would be the brightest possible colour on a scale, and 8 ones would be the darkest possible colour on a scale. So 7 zeros followed by a 1 would be slightly less bright than 8 zeros, and so on for every combination of 1s and zeros between 8 zeros and 8 1s. So there are 2 to the power 8 or 256 possible levels of brightness, but that is for each of the red, green and blue channels. That means there are 2 to the power 8 to the power 3, or 16.7 million possible colours per pixel. A 12-bit file has 4,096 levels of brightness, or 68.7 billion possible colours per pixel. That's 16 times as much as an 8-bit file. A 14-bit file has 16,384 levels of brightness, or 4.4 trillion colours possible per pixel. That's 64 times as many as an 8-bit file. And a 16-bit file has 65,536 levels of brightness, or 281.5 trillion possible colours. In other words, 0.3 quadrillion. That's 256 times as many as an 8-bit file. So it makes a massive, massive difference. And whilst JPEGs are still editable, there's no doubt about it, they're not as editable as raw files. So typically, you want to make sure that you only save to JPEG when you've reached a final image. But one of the things about that compression that brings it down to an 8-bit file format is that it's a lossy compression. So when you save it, you lose information. And one of the important things to remember is that each and every time you save it, you lose information. So if you save an image as a JPEG and then decide a few weeks later you want to go back and edit it a bit more or change it, or even just change the file size, the image size rather, then you will get loss each and every time you save it. So if you save 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 times or more, you'll get to a point where that file starts to break down and it's no longer usable because you've lost so much information that you start to get strange artifacts and unusual things happening in the photo. So that is what makes JPEGs awful. So here's a recent photo of a kingfisher that I've just edited in Photoshop. So I'm going to save the final image as a JPEG, and then I'm going to take that JPEG and save it again, and then take that JPEG and save it again, and so on, just to see how quickly this file starts to break down. So here's the final image, and if we start flicking through them, you can see that as we move through the first couple, it's fine, and then we start to get to about 6, and you start to see some blotchiness in the background, and that's the file starting to break down. So as we move on, we get to edit 10, and that blotchiness is getting really quite bad now. So let's carry on, and we move on through. By the time we get to save number 14, that blotchiness is getting really bad and very blocky and pixelated. And we continue to go through it. And by edit 20, it's getting really, really distracting. Now, bear in mind, all I've done here is save the photo continuously. If you were making changes between edits, this breakdown of the file would be even worse. So let's carry on. And as we get to 25, it's incredibly bad. And here's what it looks like at 30 saves. So that is completely unusable and just shows how quickly a JPEG can break down. But there are different methods of compressing JPEGs, and you'll have seen this if you've ever saved a JPEG out of Photoshop or some other software that gives you options as to how you compress your file to a JPEG. And you'll normally see that there are three. You'll get baseline or standard, progressive, and optimized. So let's cover what each of those are. So baseline means that when your image is shared and downloaded, it downloads it one line of pixels at a time. Now, we don't normally notice it with the speeds of the internet that we have nowadays. You might not notice it going line by line. It might appear like it's chunk by chunk. You'll get quite a few lines, then a few more, then a few more. But when you look at websites where an image appears and it appears in blocks going down the image, that has been saved as baseline or standard. And then we get progressive. That is where your image is saved in layers, and the layers become sharper as the image is downloaded. So you'll typically see a very blurry image to start with, and over the course of a few milliseconds, it gradually becomes sharper. And that's because the image is being downloaded progressively, because it's a progressive file. So there's an easy way to remember it. Baseline has the word line in it, which downloads line by line, and progressive becomes progressively sharper. But there is a third method called optimized, and optimized is effectively the same as baseline. It's downloaded line by line, but optimized compresses the colors even more. So I would recommend that you never use the optimized option. So next, moving on to TIFF files. And I think TIFF files are one of the most underrated file formats out there. I use TIFF files a lot, and the chances are that you do too, without even knowing about it. But one of the reasons that I use TIFF files is that they are lossless. Each and every time that you save it, you won't lose any information, as long as that information is within the range of the histogram. So the first time you create a TIFF file from a raw file, if you've got any information beyond the edge of the histogram, either in the white's direction or the black's direction, you will lose it. But after that point, you lose no information. It's an uncompressed and lossless file. So unlike JPEGs that compress and lose images, TIFF files don't. So whenever I get to a final image, I always save it as both a JPEG and a TIFF. And the reason being that I can come back to that TIFF at some point in the future and continue editing it from where I left off without any risk of loss. And that's really important for me. One of the things to note about that though is that TIFF files, in the way that we use them for photography, are 16-bit files. So they're capable actually of holding more information than a RAW file is, and it makes them bigger than RAW files. So if you are going to use the method I've described and save your TIFF files so that they can be edited again later, you do run the risk of having to use more hard drive space. And I have a number of hard drives with all of my images on from over the years. But that's the reason I do it. It makes those images infinitely editable. Now, one thing to note is that there are two different types of TIFF file. There's the 8-bit TIFF and the 16-bit TIFF. And you will find that typically we're never talking about the 8-bit TIFF because that tends to be used in scanning processes. So if you scan a document in on a scanner at home, or you've ever used any OCR or optical character recognition software, those type of things often save it as a TIFF and they will use the 8-bit TIFF because they don't need a load of color information. So they're looking to use a file format that is editable, but it doesn't need to be as good as a 16-bit file. In photography, when we're talking about TIFFs, we're almost always talking about the 16-bit TIFF file. Now, whenever I mention TIFF files, there's always someone who makes a comment with something they've read on the internet about TIFF files, usually to do with TIFF files being dead. TIFF files have been around a long time and they show no signs of dying because they're so useful. And as I've mentioned earlier, you probably use TIFF files without even knowing it. If you ever transfer a photo between two different pieces of software, so say for example you're in Photoshop and you want to send it off to Topaz to do the denoise on it or something like that, but it could be between any two pieces of software if you ever transfer between Lightroom and Photoshop, for example. It will only ever send those in one of two file formats. The first of those is PSD, which we'll come to, which is a Photoshop style format. But you tend to find that PSDs tend to only be used by Adobe software. There are some other software that can handle PSDs, but they're not universally accepted. The other way to send them is via a TIFF file. And by default, almost every piece of software chooses a TIFF file. So even if you send your photograph from Lightroom to Photoshop, it shows up in Photoshop with the file name extension of your RAW file. But what you're actually viewing is a TIFF file version of it. And if you dig into the EXIF data around that file, you'll see that at the point you moved it from one piece of software to another, it was sent as a TIFF file. So you're all using them regularly, unless you've deliberately chosen to change the defaults of your software to use PSDs, you will be sending them as TIFF files. Now, another important thing to note about the TIFF file is that if you ever work with a professional printer, they will almost always want to receive your file as a TIFF file. They don't want JPEGs because they want the latitude of having far more colours to make that print look good for you. They also don't want your RAW file because, remember, RAW files are just unprocessed image data. So if you send them the RAW file, it won't include the edits that you've done. What a professional printer will almost always want is a 16-bit TIFF file. And so having your file saved as a TIFF file is important for those reasons if you've reached the level where you're starting to work with professional printers. And even if you're working with a print-at-home printer, I would recommend that you do that using a TIFF file. Now, one of the things that you should always remember when printing is there's a difference between a printed file and one you look at on your screen, because most monitors are in some form backlit. And that affects colours differently. So when you get into printing, you will learn that you need to save a different file anyway for printing because you'll want to adjust the colours to account for the fact that the paper that that image becomes printed on will not be backlit. And so I would recommend you always choose a TIFF file to do that because your printer will respond better to the range of colours and the information that you can send to the printer with a TIFF file than it will something like a JPEG. Another thing that's really important to note about the TIFF is that it can support layer information. So if you're working in a software package like Photoshop that allows you to edit in layers, other software does this also, then you can save all of that layer information within the TIFF file and come back and continue editing those layers later on. So here's that kingfisher photo I showed you earlier, and I edited in Photoshop using layers. So if I go back to the raw file conversion, this is what it looked like to start with. And I didn't really like the bluey grey background. It was a very dark day that I took this photo on, so I wanted to give it a little bit more of a blue feel, move it slightly to cooler tones. So I have altered the curves and the levels, the vibrance, and added a blue photo filter to finish. So now I'm going to save this as a TIFF so that I can go back and edit it at any time in the future. So if I output that through File, Save As, and save that as a TIFF file, and I want to make sure that I choose not to compress it, and it's asking me to confirm that I'm going to include the layers and that will increase the file size. But that's okay. So now if I close this file and open it again from the TIFF file, you can see here I've got where I was at the point I finished editing. So if I want to go and play around with any of those layers that I created, for example, if I click into the curves, I can go and change that curve a bit more, or the levels, whatever I want to do, I can continue editing that again without any fear of a loss. So next, let's move on to DNG files. Now, technically, DNG files are a type of raw file. It stands for digital negative. And one of the things, though, about DNG files is that they can be saved after the fact. So they don't have to be created in camera. You can create this type of raw file from another raw file. DNGs were created by Adobe in an attempt to standardize raw file formats. So as we learned in part one, camera manufacturers don't share their sensor information with the software developers. Adobe wanted to create a standard, so the aim was that you would be able to create DNG files directly out of camera. And some cameras allow it, not all cameras do. But not all software manufacturers got on board with this. Because why would they? They would then be using a proprietary format of Adobe. So it's never really caught on in the way that Adobe intended. Many people will automatically convert their raw file into a DNG. And generally, I don't see any reason or benefit for that, apart from one thing. Something you have to remember is that file formats go out of date. So as cameras become obsolete, they're no longer produced, we move on to newer, better models, the sensors change. At some point in time, those sensors are no longer produced. And for the software manufacturers, they have to think about how long they are going to carry on supporting that particular raw file format. Is it forever? Do they support it for a few years? Do they support it till the secondary used market has sold all the cameras? That's a choice for those software manufacturers to make. But at some point in time, those raw file formats go out of date. And one of the advantages of the DNG file is that it's seen as an archival file format. So that means if you save your file as a DNG, you should, in theory, be able to use it forever, as long as Adobe and the other manufacturers, to a certain extent, carry on supporting DNGs. So I've reached a point where my Sony A-mount files that I had from old cameras that I used years ago that are no longer produced will probably in the next few years stop working. Now, I do occasionally go back and get old photos and re-edit them if they become useful. And so I might have a choice to make over the next few years as to whether I take all of those old raw file formats that were saved from my Sony A-mount cameras and convert them to DNGs just so they're archived forever and I can carry on using them. But that will take up a tremendous amount of file space on my hard drives. It is a choice for you to make though. I wouldn't recommend that you save them as DNGs directly out of camera. Some people do, But where you might want to think about it is if you've got old style file formats that are probably no longer going to be supported. So let's move on to the PSD file. So PSD stands for Photoshop Document. And as I mentioned earlier, it was created by Adobe. But some software manufacturers from other companies do also support the PSD file. Now, like the TIFF, the PSD file allows you to save and record layer information. So that's a really important use of it. You'll tend to find that graphic designers like to work in PSD files. So if you're laying out a magazine or something like that, where you're overlaying text on top of an image or an advert or something like that, those kind of things, people tend to like to use PSD files. They're equally usable for photographers though. And as I mentioned earlier, I would have no problems if I had to save everything in PSD format rather than TIFFs. The only issue is that not all software supports PSDs. So something to think about. If you're primarily an Adobe user, PSD might be the way to go. If you use other software, you might prefer to use the TIFF. So let's move on to talk about a few other file formats that sometimes get associated with photography. And in this case, we're going to talk about the SVG, the PNG, and the GIF. Now, I am using the phrase GIF. I know some people say GIF. The letters are G-I-F, but I've chosen to say GIF because the creator of that file format calls it a GIF. So if that person does, why wouldn't I? But we're going to start off by talking about the GIF. And GIFs have been important in some regards. I wouldn't recommend them for any serious photographers, but the way they are important to the internet is because they can link together individual images sequentially. So you get a sort of video type effect to the GIF. And that's why for so many of the visual memes we see on the internet, they are created in GIF format. But they are very limited in the number of colours that they can represent. And so I wouldn't ever recommend that you use a GIF for serious photography. GIFs were superseded by the PNG. And the PNG has a number of advantages over the GIF in that it can save more colours, but it can also save transparency information really well. PNGs can be useful if you ever need to overlay some graphic design on top of an image. But again, for most people, you would probably prefer to use a PSD file or something like that to do that instead of a PNG. But PNGs are worth considering for some people. And the final one is an SVG. Now, SVGs are capable of saving photos, but that's not really what they are intended for. So SVG files are really for vector graphics. So what is a vector? Well, first we need to know what a raster is. So rasters are things that can't be scaled up without losing quality. So for example, a photo is a raster image. You've got a maximum file size of the number of pixels that photo contains. And if you double the file size, if you double the number of pixels along the edges of it, then you lose quality. The picture starts to become pixelated. That's what a raster image does. Vectors, on the other hand, are infinitely scalable up and down without losing quality. So if you overlay a shape or something from graphic design to your images, those shapes can be scaled up and down without ever becoming pixelated. So again, SVGs might be useful if you incorporate an element of graphic design into your photography, but for simple photographs, you should never really use an SVG either. So another file format that is gaining in popularity is the HEIF, H-E-I-F, which stands for High Efficiency Image Format. And they're becoming more popular predominantly because of mobile phones. So Apple is really leading the charge on HEIFs. And there is some speculation that HEIFs could one day replace the JPEG. I don't see it happening anytime soon, but they are certainly gaining in popularity. And part of that is because they're a little bit more editable than JPEGs. They are also faster to download than JPEGs. And they can link images sequentially, a little bit like the GIF does. So they are really popular because they can contain both still image formats and video formats within the HEIF. So it's really good for that. And that's why mobile phone producers like the HEIF, because they don't have to switch when you switch between video and stills. So HEIF files are 8-bit files, so very much like the JPEG, they're compressed and they're lossy. There is a 10-bit version of them, but it's hardly ever used. Nobody has really picked up on the 10-bit HEIF. And so for serious photographers, the kind of photographers who take photos using a proper camera, as opposed to a mobile phone camera, HEIFs probably aren't that useful. But if you take photos with your phone, particularly an iPhone, chances are you're saving them in the HEIF format. You can change the settings on your phone to change them in other formats, but chances are you're saving images as HEIFs. But one of the reasons why the HEIF isn't catching on as quick as Apple would perhaps like is that none of the major web browsers currently supports HEIF out of the box. So there are extensions you can download for your browser that allow you to view HEIF files, but none of them do it directly out of the box, which is why if you're ever online and maybe you're looking at a website or a forum or something like that, where someone has uploaded a HEIF file, a photo they've taken with their phone, you're looking at it on your phone's browser and you can see that perfectly well. And then you go over to your desktop browser and the photo isn't there for you to see. That means your browser can't handle the HEIF file. And so its adoption hasn't been great. The other issue with the HEIF is that currently no printer manufacturers support printing of HEIF files, or certainly not the type of printers that you would print a photograph from. There are a few where you can airprint directly from your mobile phone, but nothing for serious photographers. And so the HEIF hasn't really caught on. Can I see it one day potentially replacing the JPEG? It could happen, particularly because iPhone and Apple are really pushing for it. But I don't see it happening anytime soon. My prediction is that the JPEGs will last at least another 10 years. So there are plenty of other file formats I could talk about. Perhaps the next one I can imagine people saying is, what about the bitmap file? But these become progressively less useful to people the longer the video goes on because they're less used. So I'm going to move on to talk about some general tips to do with choosing file formats. So the number one tip is, don't change file formats between edits. It can be really tempting to switch from one to another, particularly if you save things as a JPEG and then want to go back and edit things later. But particularly if your file format is lossy compression, you don't want to be switching back to something that's lossless because you'll never gain that quality back. So keep it in a lossless file format for as long as you intend to edit it. And if you think there's a chance that you might want to edit it further or again in the future, save it in a lossless file format like the PSD or the TIFF file. But also, save it at the resolution that you intend to use it at, because remember, each time that image is saved, it will lose quality if you're using a lossy compression format. So, for example, if you are creating images to upload to social media and they have a very low resolution size that they will display your image in, they will save that image again and convert it to the resolution that they need to display the image. So you get a bit of compression, you get a bit of loss. So if you look up what the file size is or the resolution of the images for the particular site you intend to display it on, then you can save it directly at that size. And if you think that there is a chance that you might need to save that file or display it at a number of different resolutions, again, save it as a lossless file type, so either TIFF or PSD. So when you've got your final image ready, and only then, save it as a JPEG, because that's where you will experience loss. But one of the things that you do want to think about with JPEG images is the fact that they're compressed down to an 8-bit file. So sometimes you will see where someone has used a gradient in editing, they've introduced a very gradual transition from one color to another. And in a 12, 14 or 16-bit file, that might look perfectly fine on your screen. But when you compress it to an 8-bit JPEG, you get that compression that leads to banding because the JPEG cannot display enough colors. So only ever think about saving as a JPEG when you get to the final image. But even when you save it as a JPEG, if you've used a gradient at some point in your editing, check that file carefully to make sure that you're not displaying banding in the image that you output, because you might want to change that gradient to something that the JPEG can handle. So just to show you this gradient effect I'm talking about, I've reopened the kingfisher photo from earlier. And if I go to add a gradient here, I'm going to choose a radial gradient, and let's go for a yellow one. And if I change that gradient to change from 100% opacity in the middle through to 100% yellow at the edges, you can see there we've got the kingfisher in the middle moving through to yellow. Now, not great, wouldn't want to create a photo like this, but it's just to show you the effect. And if I zoom in, you can see there it's a very smooth transition from the kingfisher to the yellow. It might look a little less smooth on your screen because of the compression that happens with YouTube videos, but on my screen, it looks like a very smooth transition. So now I'm going to save this as a JPEG and output it. And if we zoom into the same place in the photo, you can see there some circular bands, and that's the banding effect that I'm talking about. The JPEG, an 8-bit file, can't handle the same transition from transparency through to yellow that the TIFF file can, for example, because it's got far fewer colours available to it to use. And that's how you end up with this banding effect. So if you want to use gradients in your editing and you're outputting them as a JPEG, you just need to remember to use much more subtle gradients, because then you'll avoid having this banding in your final image. And finally, never try to get quality back by saving a compressed file into an uncompressed file format. It just won't work. It never does. I've certainly experienced in the past where people have sent me things in uncompressed file formats like a TIFF, and I can see that it was saved as a JPEG because it's lost quality. You will never gain that quality back by saving it as an uncompressed file after compressing it. So if you do need to do that, if you need to send something off as a TIFF, for example, or a PSD, then you really need to go back and edit again from scratch from that raw file to get the quality that you need for that uncompressed image. So over the last two videos, we've covered a lot of information about file formats. And if you're interested in seeing how I use some of those file formats to my advantage, you might like to check out my photo editing playlist. Thanks very much for watching, and I'll see you next time.